Good morning, everyone. I'm Sriram. I work at Facebook. I work as Android UI engineer. My day-to-day job is to create Android UI widgets that will be used by different products inside Facebook. Yeah? Sure. So today I'm going to talk about abstract UI concepts. These are some techniques that you can use in your apps when you are ran out of ideas in optimizing UI performance. So if you look at apps in the Play Store, most of them are giant list views. They show a lot of stories. Here is an example where Facebook is showing a lot of stories. It could be from a user, it could be some forum. It shows a title reflecting either the username or the page name and some content in it, and so on. This is the Strava app. Here again, it's a set of multiple stories, and then this is Dig, and here is a Gmail. So typically, we all deal with list views and list view rows. The height and the contents inside each row varies. So how do we optimize or how do we change the way we think about these rows? So to get a common base, let's define some feed story as something like this. We have a profile photo, some username, some piece of text, and then some secondary row showing some more information and a row of buttons. We all know how list view recycling works. So let's say we have 7 items that can be shown in the screen. As the user scrolls, the items that go away from the screen are moved to a recycle bin, and new ones are either coming back from the recycle bin or being inflated. The set of steps that happen here is vaguely like this. So the list view calls its adapter's getView method, which would inflate a new view, and then it would do a measure pass on the view that was returned, the layout pass, and then add this view to the list view. Now, the measure pass is pretty expensive. If you have a huge view, like what we saw now, then it would have to measure and sometimes remeasure the same view again and again, which is not even effective. The place where this exactly happens is, let's say we have this huge feed story, and then the user tries to scroll this particular app. When a very small portion is seen at the bottom, it tries to inflate the next row, which is really huge, and so much measure pass happens. To avoid this, we can employ something like breaking the rows. Instead of treating one big story as one row in your list view, you can split it into multiple rows. For example, in this case, you can treat the header as one row, the content portion as the other row, and then the secondary icons as the third row, and the footer icons as fourth row. This way, we split the way Android recycles all these rows. This is not just good for list views, this is also good for the recycler view introduced by Android. So now, with the same scrolling, at this point when it has to inflate a new feed story, it won't inflate the entire feed story, but it would just inflate just the header view that is needed for that particular portion. Thereby we reduce the measure happening on these views. Here's some example code that can achieve this. In my case, I'm defining 4 different rows per feed story. This piece of code resides inside the adapter. And the view type code written by this adapter is 4. And the view type depends on that particular position that the adapter requests. So my getView would return and bind model just required for that particular piece of the story and not for the entire story. So what are the advantages of doing something like this? As I said, less binding time and less measure time. We also reduce the view depth. Think of having an entire feed story where you have linear layout of linear layouts or relative layouts. Here, the content portion can be just one text view instead of it being inside another linear layout. The next approach you can use is going beyond what Android provides. Like instead of using linear layout or relative layouts, you can use custom view groups. These are really helpful if your layout is pretty complex. So here is an example. The first one is from Facebook. This is the normal header you see in each and every post. This one is from Strava. The common thing is they have a profile view, some title text, and some subtitle text. So let's define something like this and see how much time it takes to measure this particular view if you use standard Android components. So here is the same thumbnail, title, subtitle, and a small menu button. We can use a linear layout of linear layouts. In this case, we have the title and subtitle inside a vertical linear layout, and this, along with the thumbnail and the menu icon, are inside a horizontal linear layout. So I logged how much measure pass happens for this particular case inside Android. This is what we get. It basically tries to measure how much time it takes, how much space it needs for the inner linear layout, and then measures it again. Clearly, the title subtitle is measured thrice, which is not really good, because the text views are the ones that are going to take more time in your measure pass. So we need to optimize on that. We can also use relative layouts. So in this case, all the elements in this particular view are placed relative to one another. In this case, subtitle is placed below title. The thumbnail is always on the left and top of the view, and the menu is on the right and top of the view. By logging the measure passes, I found that it takes it measures every view twice, which is again not needed at all. So if we were to measure it ourselves, if we were to design this particular thing ourselves, the way we would do it is we would place the thumbnail first. We know how much space it takes. And then we would measure the menu button. We know how much space it takes. So the remaining space is given to the title and the subtitle to measure. So in this case, every single view is measured only once. This cuts down the measure pass by half. So this is another technique which you can use to reduce the time taken during binding in your list views. Here is how you achieve it. In your measure pass, you try to measure each and every view individually by yourselves. Android provides a lot of helper methods to do it, but sometimes you would have to overwrite few methods. So in my measure, I'm measuring the thumbnail view first, and based on how much width it takes, I'm measuring the title. So in line number 14, you can see that I'm adding the width constraints to be the measured width of the thumbnail. This restricts the view that this restricts the width that the title can take. This only shows example for thumbnail and title, but you can extend it for subtitle, menu, and so on. And then all those were calling this particular method measure child with margins. The default implementation of Android uses padding when you call this, but in our case, we Can you hear me? So we can use measure child with margins to achieve the same. The idea here is we create measure spec for individual views and then call child.measure, which would measure individual views. This way, this is the approach. With this approach, we can measure individual things ourselves. So we saw how much measure pass it takes to do linear layout of linear layouts, especially with weights. If we had to do the same thing here, we would be calling measure pass again and again. In this case, we can go start with the thumbnail, measure it, and give the remaining space for the title. We can measure the content portion separately, and then we can measure the individual button separately. So for example, in the last column, we can say that instead of saying, oh, measure, let the buttons take whatever space it needs, and then enforce saying it should only be the 50% of the width. We can say the buttons to take 50% of the width the first time we ask it to measure. It's not like you shouldn't use this approach with the break the rows, or you should you cannot use this with break the rows approach. If you want, you can apply both the approaches together for more performance win. The only problem with this approach is there is a bit of problem with code maintainability. Only the person who wrote it sort of knows like where he placed whatever things, because this is not as descriptive as XML. So otherwise, this can cut down a lot of cost that you would incur by using standard Android widgets. The next topic is about the subviews that we use in Android. So first we saw about a giant story. Now let's move down to the text views in those stories. So there are view groups like linear layout, relative layout, and all the stuff which can have one or more views or view groups in it. The popular ones are image views and text views. Image views show drawables in them. These are more like subviews. The reason being, they cannot have any interaction from the user. You cannot tap them, you cannot have click events, you cannot have touch events in them. Everything is controlled by the image view. Similarly, the text view has a text layout. You can create text layouts. It's not pretty simple as creating a drawable, but still layouts are more effective if you want to use them. As a piece of trivia, Gmail found that it's not effective to use text views, so the entire Gmail app uses text layouts instead of views. Same goes with Twitter and Pinterest. So what are these layouts? You can think of them as drawables for text views. They contain all the information that you give to them. Whenever you call setText, it creates the layout, and it contains all that particular information in them. It also contains information about the spannables, it contains information about image spans, and so on. And it also has the same method as drawable. You can call layout or draw to a canvas, and it will draw to the canvas. So why do we need to worry about layouts when we have text views? So again, back to list view recycling. When the view gets recycled, it moves to the recycle bin and then comes back. And in your get call, you keep setting the text on this particular text view. Every time you set a text on this text view, this is what vaguely happens. In your set text, it sees, should it do a relayout? If it needs to do a relayout, it creates a new layout. Think of a scenario where the user scrolls down a bit and then scrolls up a bit and then scrolls down again. He goes through the same set of rows back and forth again and again, and we are not recreating the views, but we are recreating the layouts again and again, which is costing us so much of memory allocation, so much of object allocation and stuff. So instead of doing that, we can cache all these layouts. We can take those layouts, put it in a cache. So in my set text, I'm passing a key based on the particular row that I want to use. And using that key, I'm trying to see if a layout has already been created for this particular text. If it has already been created, I'm using that layout. If not, I'm going to create a new layout. And in my draw, I'm just calling mlayout.draw. This will have the same effect as what TextView would do it for you. So again, the advantage is less object creation. You have more control over the cache. And the measuring cost is saved because it's going to be measured only once. The next time you can just get them width from the layout. You don't have to recreate more layouts again and again. But there are a few things we need to watch out for. What if the orientation changes? If it changes from portrait to landscape, the width available for the title or subtitle would increase now, in which case we would have to nuke the entire layout cache and rebuild everything from start. And similarly with local changes as well. Again, back to the same slide, we are drawing everything to the canvas. Starting with ICS, they introduced display list, which basically caches all the GPU commands, which is really effective because it caches the commands and then replays them back, which is a huge performance win. But this is not available pre-Gingerbread. What can we do to achieve somewhat similar performance in Gingerbread phones? Android has something called picture drawables. The idea here is you cache all the commands that you send to the canvas and then replay them back. So the same code I changed to use picture canvas. The picture is something that can record all the calls you give it to a canvas. In my Android call, if nothing is recorded already, I'm creating a new canvas. So when I start a recording, like mpicture.begin recording, it returns me a new canvas. All my calls, like super.draw or mlayout.draw, is passed to the picture canvas. And the next time this particular view gets invalidated, I'm calling mpicture.draw. This is like the cached version of commands. And this approach gave like, without this approach, it took like 18 milliseconds for me to render text with one particular example. And with this particular approach, it got significantly lower, and it just took 3 milliseconds. So this is another approach that you can use. One caveat here is that you can use this only with software rendering model. Hardware rendering model doesn't support picture drawables. The next thing is about images. Our apps have a lot of images, a lot of glyphs. For example, this is Facebook app, and these are the list of icons shown in this particular screen. This is very, very less compared to the whole lot of icons we ship as a part of the APK. So how do we handle this? And Android web introduced this concept of sprites. Instead of downloading one image after another, sending a request to the server, making a connection, and downloading the image, you can download one giant image with all possible images in it, and then draw portions of it in each and every image view. Android has started doing this. They call it Texture Atlas. It's the same name in OpenGL world as well. Here is the texture atlas used by standard Android and Jelly Bean. This gets generated every time you power on your device. And every time Android has to draw a piece of this, it uses the same texture, it binds this texture, and then draw portions of this. So why is this actually needed, or why is this going to give us performance wins? So before Jelly Bean, if we had two buttons in our app like this, it would go view after view. It would draw the background of first one and then draw the text one. It would go to the second button, draw its background, and then draw the text. After Jelly Bean, they changed it where they batch and merge these commands, immaterial of the view. So all the backgrounds will be batched and they will be drawn first, and then the text will be drawn next. The reason is, these two backgrounds share the same texture. So they bind the texture once, they draw them first, and then the characters usually share the same texture if they have the same font size, color, and so on. So they bind that texture, and then they draw that text. This reduces the number of commands that they pass to the GPU. So if you are going to use something like Sprite, then you're going to bind the texture once, you're going to draw all the images in one single draw command, instead of passing like 10, 15 different draw commands in case of the Facebook screenshot. And how hard it is to implement something like this on pre-Jelly Bean, because this is something you get it for free in Jelly Bean. How hard it is to implement in pre-Jelly Bean is this simple. Canvas has this method called draw bitmap. In this, you need to pass in the bitmap that you want to use, and then the next two arguments are the source and the destination rectangle. The source rectangle is that piece, portion in the bitmap that needs to be drawn on the screen, and the destination is the piece on the view where it should be drawn. And Android would map the source and the destination, and then would draw that particular bitmap to the destination. So this is a bit more complex thing. It uses the same technique in line number line. It's the same API call. The here I'm setting the coordinates on the view with top, left, right, and bottom. And in my draw call, I'm getting the destination rectangle. And then the destination rectangle here would not have the padding, or maybe if you want to offset something, or if you want to have more customizations, you can put anything in that destination rectangle. By calling this, it uses the same bitmap and then draws that particular portion. So will this have any effect post Jelly Bean? Of course, yes, because you're still having one single texture, you're binding the same texture again and again and then drying it. So you would see performance improvements even after Jelly Bean with this approach. So again, the advantage is you're binding one single bitmap and sending less commands to the GPU. Next is color tinting. We all know this was introduced in Lollipop. This is a cool feature if you want to reduce the number of images in your APK. So the need arises for something like this. Say the tab bar icons have the disabled state, enabled state, and then the selected state. Clearly we have like three different images that we need to ship with every single glyph. That increases the APK size a lot. How can we mitigate this problem, or how can we reduce the amount of images we ship in our APK? So you can use something like a color filter that can achieve this for you. I'm taking a black glyph, and then I am applying a color filter to get the gray one. Android provides various color filters, like PortaDef color filters, lightning color filters, and so on. The PortaDef is pretty easy to use, and that would help you a lot in this particular case. The way it's basically an alpha composting method. That means whatever you want to draw now, you give it an operation saying, this is how I want to draw this particular thing onto whatever is already available. In this case, the destination is the purple-blue circle. The source is the red square. So when you are about to draw the red square, you can say like, I want to draw the source or the destination. So the red square will be drawn on whatever is already available on the canvas. Or you can say destination over. In this case, the destination was this purple blue circle that will be drawn below the after what is what you want to draw. But in case of color tinting, what we need is source and mode. What this basically means is draw pieces of source that overlaps with whatever is already on the destination. So wherever you see black parts on the canvas, or wherever you see non-zero alpha parts on the canvas, then you could use a different color to redraw it. So if I have, say, a black icon like this, and then I use a gray color, and then, say, use a source and PortaDef mode, then it would just shade that portion with a gray color. So clearly, you can use one single glyph, and then use different colors, thereby recreating all different states. So this is how we do it. It's again a very small piece of code. You create a PortaDef filter with the tint color, the mode is sourcing, and then you set this color filter on the drawable. If you are using this inside an image view, you can just set the color filter on the image view itself. But will it scale for state changes, or how hard it is to manage state changes? Say if you have a state pressed, if you were having icon for press state, and now you want to simulate the same thing, would you have to monitor touch events and so on? Actually, you don't have to monitor state changes because Android provides a drawable state change. Before that, let's say we define a selector like this. Here, I'm defining the disable state to be gray, enable to be white, and the selected state to be blue. I'm going to use this color state list with my view, whatever that I'm implementing. In my drawable state change, I'm trying to get the state using get drawable state, and then the tint color is obtained from that particular color state list. With that color tint color, I'm creating a new PortaDef filter, and I'm applying that color filter to this particular image view. Thereby, you can reduce quite a lot of images in your app. You can also combine this with sprites, because again, sprites is going to bind one single texture, and then it can. This is done at canvas level, so this will work cleanly with sprites as well. And that's pretty much it for today. Yep. Right.
You're basically forcing the app to use more battery and CPU.
These are done at a GPU level, and I don't think this would take more battery, because this is something Android provides out of the box. So this is not like a complex operation, especially if you think portaDef is a pretty complex operation. This is like a standard window composting operation that is available on any windowing system, and this is a pretty basic operation to compose different views and so on. So this is not a CPU intensive operation. Which particular approach in this?
The portaDef mode that you told about.
PortaDef mode is available since early days of Android. So to give some more context, if you want to create rounded bitmaps and stuff, using PortaDef mode is the most effective solution than having two or three layers or applying a mask in a different way and stuff. So this is, I would say like starting with gingerbread, you can safely apply this approach. Thanks, guys.